evening and welcome to this great event. We are the Black Rain Step Team and we're opening up tonight's celebration with the Greensboro sit-in.
Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land, to let my people go.
Now when Israel was in Egypt land,
let my people go.
So hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
So the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down, down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
Civil rights in that context, Martin Luther King and his movement, was about enforcement of rights. Because legally, people had equal rights as early as 1865 or 1866, when the 13th, 14th, and 15th amendments of the Constitution were passed. Just to refresh, those are the amendments that abolished slavery.
Thank you. And around 4, police arrested the remaining protesters and charged them with trespassing.
Good evening, everyone. We are the Young and Talented Hip Hop Dance and Culture Performing Arts Company, and we are proud to present our dance and step performance of I Have Been to the Mountaintop.
All we say to America is be true to what you said on paper. If I lived in China or even Russia or any totalitarian country, maybe I could understand some of these illegal injunctions. Maybe I could understand the denial of certain basic First Amendment privileges because they haven't committed themselves to that over there. But somewhere I read of the freedom of assembly. Somewhere I read of the freedom of speech. Somewhere I read of the freedom of press. Somewhere I read that the greatness of America is the right to protest far right. And so just as I say we aren't gonna let any dogs or water hoses turn us around, we aren't gonna let any injunction turn us around. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And He's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Good evening. My name is Bridget Ewell, and I am the 2018 Martin Luther King Jr.'s Celebration Committee Chairperson. To all in attendance and those listening at home, I would like to begin by acknowledging with respect the Onondaga Nation, the indigenous people on whose ancestral lands Syracuse University now stands. This is the 33rd annual Martin Luther King celebration. This year's theme, Remember, Celebrate, Act, From Intention to Impact. Before I continue, I would like to read a statement from Governor Andrew Cuomo commemorating January 15, 2018 as Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day in the state of New York. Each January, New Yorkers and all Americans join together to honor the birthday of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., born on January 15, 1929. Dr. King was dedicated to fulfilling his vision of a world free of hatred and violence, and through both words and deeds, he illustrated his commitment to civil rights, human dignity, and the determination to follow a course of social change with his message of freedom, equality, and justice for all. Few individuals have raised the collective consciousness of our nation and the entire world as did Dr. King, and we find inspiration in the values he personified as one of our nation's most cherished icons. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King is looked to as an example for today's leaders and those of tomorrow. Forever admired for his commitment to the ideals of equality and his respect and compassion for all humankind. Therefore, I, Andrew M. Cuomo, Governor of the State of New York, do proclaim January 15, 2018 as Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day in the Empire State. Please join me in thanking Governor Cuomo for sharing that proclamation with all of us tonight. Now to this evening's events. We have a wonderful program prepared tonight, which I hope you will enjoy. The keynote speaker tonight is Angela Rye, who will be introduced by our 2018 Syracuse University Senior Class Marshals, Gerald Adiva Brown, a senior in the College of Visual and Performing Arts, and Angie Patty, a senior in the College of Arts and Sciences. Now, if you would please turn your attention to the screen for a special welcome from Syracuse University's 12th Chancellor and President, Kent Severud.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the 33rd annual Martin Luther King Jr. celebration at Syracuse University. Once again, this is the largest university-sponsored event in the nation honoring the life and legacy of Dr. King. I plan to be with you tonight in the Dome for this important celebration. If you are watching this recorded greeting, it is because my flight home to Syracuse this morning was long delayed. Please know that I am making my way to the Dome as quickly as I can. I want to be with you tonight to honor Dr. King and this year's remarkable group of unsung heroes. I also am eager to hear the vital message of this year's keynote speaker, Angela Rye. Angela Rye, in words and deeds, has shown us how to inspire positive change. I thank Bridget Yule and the entire planning committee for all the work they have done to organize this event. I also thank Dr. Brian Conkle, our new Dean of Hendricks Chapel. I look forward to his new ideas and the fresh energy that he will contribute to help guide and rejuvenate this gathering from this point forward. The whole world has just marked the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, started by Martin Luther. That movement changed nations and institutions. It was not easy and is still debated today. In 1934, a pastor, Michael King, left the southern United States to visit the sites of the Reformation in Europe. On his return, he eventually changed his name to Martin Luther King Sr. and his young son's name to Martin Luther King Jr. That son, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., is who we remember today. Dr. King stood for many things, including courage, truth, justice, compassion, dignity, humility, and service. But like Martin Luther, he particularly stood for and demanded change. On Dr. King's visits to Syracuse University, he spoke out against racism and colonialism. He said that if America is to be a first-class nation, it must have no second-class citizens. We must get rid of the notion that there are superior and inferior races. There may be superior or inferior individuals in any race, but no one race holds a prerogative. Tonight, I ask that everyone at Syracuse University remember that message. It remains highly salient. This university, at its best, has proudly welcomed men and women, students and faculty and staff from all races, all nations, all faiths, and belief systems. Hendricks Chapel, which oversees this celebration each year, is today home to 23 religious groups and 10 chaplaincies representing all the world's major religions. Those chaplaincies and groups work together often, as did many under the leadership of Dr. King, for justice and peace, and to promote the equal dignity of every human being. I'm grateful that Hendricks Chapel and its people are leading us in remembering and acting under the inspiration of Dr. King. I ask that all of us join and celebrate in that effort. Welcome and thank you.
Good evening. My name is Brian Conkle. I serve as the Dean of Hendricks Chapel. Please join me. We gather to remember. We remember in order to celebrate. We celebrate in order to act. So we remember. We remember the values that define both character and leadership. We remember that which empowers the revolutionary spirit. We remember the courage required to transform voice and vision into struggle and sacrifice. And we celebrate. We celebrate a leader who not only dreamed of possibility, but who dove into harsh reality. We celebrate a visionary who deepened his roots by extending his reach. We celebrate the strength to sustain and the audacity to endure. And we act. We act to do our part in bending the arc of the universe. We act to express values and resist fears. We act to turn intention into impact. This is our prayer. We do trust that it is God's desire. Amen.
At this time, will everyone please stand as we sing one verse and chorus of the National Black Anthem, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
My name is Gerald Brown. I am a studio arts major with a concentration in ceramics and sculpture. And a minor in entrepreneurship.
My name is Angie Patty, double major in psychology and neuroscience with a triple minor in public communications, health and wellness, and biology.
And we are your 2018 senior class marshals. We are so honored to introduce this year's keynote speaker, Angela Rye, an acclaimed CNN political commentator and NPR political analyst. Ms. Angela Rye is committed to increasing the knowledge of the political process for her colleagues, peers, and others nationwide. As an empowermentor and activist, Rye actively confronts problematic legislation while slaying in the political arenas. going toe-to-toe with politicians and other analysts. Rye is unafraid and unapologetic. She has over a decade of experience in government contracting, homeland security, civil rights, higher education, and political fundraising, to name a few.
Born and raised in Seattle, Washington, Ryan learned the importance of advocacy through her family's political and community activism. She's a proud graduate of the University of Washington and Seattle University School of Law. She continues to honor and challenge us to live in Martin Luther King Jr.'s words every day, whether it's demanding criminal justice reform or openly questioning what we choose to stand for. Rye has an unwavering commitment to ensuring positive change in the political process. Everyone, please help us welcome the 33rd Martin Luther King Jr. Celebration speaker, Ms. Angela Rye.
Thank you all so much. That dramatic pause was not intentional. Just had a little minor logistical change. Thank you all so very, very much for this amazing invitation. To be welcomed so warmly by the Syracuse University community has been so humbling. I got to spend the first part of the afternoon with some amazing students. You all really missed a special treat. I think I learned more from them than they learned from me. Thank you to your chancellor, to the chair of this year's program, Bridget Yule, and of course to, I have a brother named Brian, but I have a new brother named Brian, who is the dean of Hendricks Chapel. So thank you all so very much. To all the committee members, I would tell you to stand, but you'll be mad at me because I have a plane to catch after this, so I don't want to cut the speech too short. I hope today with these remarks that I will leave you all just as inspired as your community has left me today. So thank you again for this invitation. From intention to impact is the theme for this year's program. I've been told of the many people who've come before me, and I know I have some big shoes to fill. Luckily, I came with some good boots. They may not be marching boots, but they'll have to suffice today. And I hope that, again, you all won't just leave inspired, but you'll leave ready to actually make a real impact. Our intentions can be very pure, but if our intentions never move us to real action, we've not done much. I had the great opportunity of listening to Dr. King's speech in 1965 that he delivered to the Syracuse community. And one of the things that is really resonating with me is something that I plan to keep as a mantra, not just during our Martin Luther King celebrations that will end as soon as Black History Month begins, but I want to keep it with me all year long. I chose the word freedom as my word for this year. My cousin challenged me to pick a word, and so my word is freedom. And he said in that speech in 1965, we will win our freedom. And I want us to remember that that is still a possibility, and while we have not come as nearly as far as Dr. King probably would have expected from that great vision he saw on the mountaintop, we have so much further to go, but we have come very far. And even though some of us may argue, including me, that we might have backslid just a little bit, thank you to your president, we're going to continue marching forward, right? So I was raised in the house with an activist and an educator. My mother is a retired educator now. She worked at Shoreline Community College, worked on every affirmative action commission you could think of. And my father, to this day, still carries a bullhorn in his trunk. I don't know why. There's no pet name for this bullhorn. There certainly should one. He keeps it closer than he keeps the family members. But the bullhorn stays close. And also, if you go into my parents' garage, you'll see big white plastic signs that have big black protest letters on them, or sometimes they're red. My mom's been trying to throw the signs away forever. He's not letting her do it. But being raised that way meant that activism, our actions to defend people who couldn't speak up for themselves, were required. It was mandatory for us to work on behalf of those who were voiceless, of those who felt invisible, That was a requirement in my home, and it wasn't a requirement because they forced it on you. It was a requirement because of what I got to see. In Dr. King's 1967 speech entitled, Where Do We Go From Here?, which he delivered at the 11th annual SCLC convention in Atlanta, he also authored a book with the same title. And as a side note, I'll just tell you all, it is amazing to see the number of parallels and similarities that exist for our current situation right now in 2018. But in that 1967 speech, Dr. King delivers a State of the Union, so to speak, because we're just a couple of days away from the one for the country. And he's talking about what SCLC has accomplished. He's trying to prove the impact of the work of this organization that he founded. And it's so interesting to me that here he is, 10 years really into the work they've been doing, and people are still questioning the relevance of this organization. By then, they had Rosa Parks who refused to get up off the bus. They had the Montgomery bus boycott as a result. They had the March on Washington for jobs and freedom. They had the Civil Rights Act of 1964. They forced Lyndon B. Johnson's hand to sign. They had the Fannie Lou Hamer sitting before a congressional committee saying she's sick and tired of being sick and tired. Lyndon B. Johnson cuts in with the press conference, right? Just so that people don't see the impact of her words. As a result of that movement and everything Fannie Lou Hamer and so many other people were doing in the South, Voting Rights Act of 1965 was passed, and shortly after that speech he delivered, they had the Fair Housing Act of 1968. Yet and still, all of that action, both seen and unseen, the relevance, right, of SCLC being challenged, that's astounding to me. And Dr. King said something really, really profound in that speech to me. He defined power. And that's what I feel like we need to move from intentions to impact, is power. He defined power as the ability to achieve purpose. But in this country, power has been used to fuel oppression, which I would define as the ability to prevent purpose. We're gonna go to church a little bit today. So with the very flawed foundation of this country, starting from the stealing of land from America's indigenous people, how would you feel if you built a magnificent mansion and somebody came in the front door, you left unlocked because you're warm and also feel safe, you welcome your guests and they told you that you could only stay in the laundry room, that would be a reservation. That's okay, I don't need anybody to clap, that's the truth and it hurts. But it's Sunday, so we're gonna keep going to church. Let's look at the transatlantic slave trade. Families ripped apart from the west coast of Africa, chained together in the belly of a dark ship, human waste, stench of death, only unchained to be bathed by cold salt water on the deck of that ship from ocean water being dumped on you from buckets. When you arrive to the shores of America the Beautiful, you are auctioned off in too many instances, once again divided from family and loved ones, sold, but the check you'll never see because your labor is for free, often until death. And you're wondering why we're still screaming Black Lives Matter. Because while we have mattered to us from the beginning of time, the question has yet existed since we set foot on the soil of America the Beautiful. This is hard, but it's real. I think about NFL combines and the prison industrial complex that sound eerily familiar to that same slave trade. Certainly not as brutal, but just as troubling. I'm gonna move away from that, but I'm boycotting the NFL right now. And yet, even now, there are industries, there are big brand names. We talked about brands earlier, right, students? They're big brand names that benefited from slave labor. But yet, the moment you say the R word, I'm not talking about racism, I'm talking about reparations. The moment you say reparations, right, people get quiet like this room. Because they'll be damned if they pay you for some work you did. They don't even want to pay you fair wages now. There's arguments about the minimum wage. Forget inflation. I'm off my notes. Let me get back on script.
even now, industries eerily familiar benefiting from the labor for free from the prison industrial complex I just talked about. There's industries that are benefiting from undocumented people who are championing the bigotry of this president, don't want to defend the people who just need their papers, but want to benefit from their labor. You gotta be kidding me. So you want to build that wall, but wait until that wall hits your pocket real hard.
You don't want this truth. There's an economic cost to bigotry. So emancipation, the Emancipation Proclamation, was too figurative and not literal enough. We were told we were free, but not given the proper tools for our liberation. And we're not the only community that suffered from an idea that you were too different, you were too other, so you need to be kept out. I'm thinking about the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. I'm thinking about Japanese internment in 1942. And then there's the Jim Crow South. I don't have a lot of time, so I have to skip through this, but I really am feeling this. And now you have your president, Donald Trump, with that damn wall and shitholes for countries. That's not my words, those are his words. And it's disgusting. It hurts every time I say it, but that's what he said. The real shithole is his mouth. And I know I said it was church, but I feel like when Jesus went into the temple and flipped the tables over, he might have been cussing. I feel like he might have been cussing. Sorry to the chancellor and to my brother Brian. I was listening to the invocation, Brian, I promise. But y'all's president isn't just trying to, y'all's, because he's not mine, isn't just trying to undo the legacy of President Obama, but rather the very legacy of civil rights that Dr. King fought so hard for, that all his comrades fought so hard for, that which blazed the trail for there to even be a Barack Obama. And with the State of the Union just a few days away, we have to recognize where we really are so we see real change, the kind that comes from intention to impact. Since Hurricane Maria hit Puerto Rico, it's been more than 122 days since they've had power. For some residents in Flint, Michigan, it's been more than 1,300 days without clean water to drink, to bathe, to cook. For Dreamers, who received a promise of citizenship under Barack Obama's presidency, they are now facing threats of deportation despite the fact that being in the U.S. was not a choice they made themselves. Yeah. After years of being treated as sex objects and property, there are women who for the first time in their lives feel seen and heard because of the Me Too movement, and Time's Up is working to ensure even more parity to protect workers making less, who will too be seen and heard. There are wage disparities, criminal justice issues, gun control issues, the war on drugs part two. And so the question really becomes, how can we use power, remember, the ability to achieve purpose, how can we use power for good, for positive change? And how great power is when there's unity. There's a scripture that says, how can two walk together lest they touch and agree? Yes. So today we've got to agree on some things. All of the things that I just laid out for you aren't right. We've got to embrace the fact that they've happened, whether you like that history or not. Christopher Columbus didn't find this place. He was lost. That's how folks started getting called Indians. We've got to embrace the truth so we can repair the foundation. The foundation is woefully flawed, and until we fix the foundation, people will be oppressed. They will not be able to achieve power because you're doing the very opposite for them so that they can never achieve their purpose. That's okay. I'll take the five claps. I'm gonna keep going because I got a plane to catch. That was not an encouragement to clap. As long as you leave here and you act, I'm good. You don't have to say another word.
In Dr. King's 67 speech, he talked about affordable housing and home ownership, aid for the poor, job creation, voter registration, voter education, and GOTV efforts. That's get out the vote efforts. He talked about establishing and supporting financial institutions that are black owned so that we build generational wealth and we can ensure that our businesses have the access to capital to thrive. He even talked about ways to support minority-owned businesses and to apply pressure on majority-owned businesses to ensure that our doors of business always stay open. He said, if you respect my dollar, you must respect my person. He said, we will no longer spend our money where we cannot get substantial jobs. Dr. King laid out a roadmap in that speech, and it's one that we still have yet to truly follow. So I don't want you to tell me about his dream when you support policies that make the reality of far too many a nightmare. Don't tell me about the content of my character when you are profiling, stopping and frisking, setting unaffordable bail, doling out harsh sentences, and wrongfully convicting our brothers and sisters. Don't tell me about love when you and your closest white evangelical friends aren't just cowering to fascism and racism and bigotry, also known as Trumpism. You all are defending it as long as you are silent. Do not tell me about love. Don't tell me about justice rolling down like waters when your silence is deafening as we watch the Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, take the Department of Justice back to the days of the Department of Injustice. Oh no, you're gonna honor the real legacy of Dr. King today, not that made-up feel-good nonsense narrative you push to make yourself feel better. It's gonna be from intention to impact. And if we have to today, we're gonna reset your intentions so that it's right, so that you really move the needle for people who are just trying to make it and be free in this country. It is time out for that. Reset your intentions. So where do we go from here? That's a holistic question. It's about who we are and where we are spiritually, physically, economically, culturally, politically. Holistically, where do we go from here? There was a question asked of me earlier about what you do when you're just tired and you don't want to talk about self-care. He said, when the self-care person says, just shut up. And it's because we're not caring for each other. We see each other struggling. And because we have our own struggles, we think we don't have the energy to support you in your struggle. That can't be further from the truth. It is the biggest lie the devil ever told. We cannot do this together, y'all, without each other. We were created to be interdependent, not independent, not standing solo, not rolling alone. We can't make this alone. We need each other. And here's my bottom line. This is a faith-based school. And so I feel very comfortable telling you, hell, even if it's a room full of atheists, I'm still gonna feel very comfortable telling you, we can't go anywhere from here without faith. We cannot sit here and watch our activism. Where we go from here requires going. It requires movement. We know that biblically, faith without works is dead faith. That means that even our faith must be rooted in action. We must be moving. We must be doing something. We must be advancing. And recently, I read a devotional that really hit me hard because this devotional was about pressing, about acting even when you don't feel like it. And I don't feel like it right now because I'm tired of every time I open up what used to be my favorite social media application, Twitter, I gotta go, oh. Like, here we go again. So sometimes I don't feel like it. Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, I might not feel like it. Sorry, it's a little tantrum. But if it was about feelings, I would have still been in the bed since the November 2016 election. I still don't feel excited about politics, but I gotta believe in the things that I cannot see and know that it's a process that we must change to work for us because we've been working for it a long time, and it's time for that thing to change and work on our behalf. My devotional, though. So, the scripture they used was Hebrews 11:27, and the young folks know we were talking about Moses earlier. I had to get Sunday school, but that was all right. It was by faith that Moses left the land of Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He kept right on going because he kept his eyes on the one who is invisible. By faith, he left, he went, he moved, he took action. By faith, he kept right on going, keeping his eyes on the prize. By faith, Moses kept going. And maybe, Moses and the children of Israel wandering is a little bit too long ago for you. I get it, there's some young people in here. But what about Black Moses? That's Harriet Tubman. It was by faith that Harriet Tubman went back 19 times to get 300 slaves, keeping her eyes on the prize. 300 slaves. What about Garrison Frazier? You probably haven't heard of Garrison Frazier. He was a 67-year-old man, a minister who was a spokesman for a group of 20 Black ministers who met with Union General William Sherman and the Secretary of War Edwin Stanton. Thursday, January 12, 1865 in Savannah, Georgia. They met with him, answering a question about what they would do with their freedom on behalf of all of us to secure 40 acres and a mule. We'll get back to the fact that we don't have the 40 acres or the mule, but they did have that meeting. It was by faith they did that meeting. Dr. King, who of course we are honoring today, hating the oppressor, but loving the oppressed. It was by faith that he said, if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. What about Barack Obama, who was my last real president? Who ran and won when they told him he was too Black, not Black enough, had a funny name, had funny ears. And, okay, that's all right. By faith. If we go exclusively by what we see, we can feel like things aren't changing and get discouraged, especially now. We can, by repeating ourselves, our varying calls to action, screaming our demands, and feel like it's not resonating. But I'm here to tell you today, to hell with your feelings. While you're in your feelings, Jeff Sessions is developing an enforcement plan against the recreational use of marijuana, which means our sons, daughters, brothers, and sisters will be targeted and jailed, adding their Black and brown bodies to an incarceration system designed to be the next step post-slavery that you don't feel like you have the energy to address. While you're in your feelings, Alabama closed down driving license locations in disproportionately Black areas, making it harder for people who look like me and you and some of your neighbors in here, because I know it's diverse, making it harder for us to register to vote. And Alabama just tried real, real hard to elect a pedophile to Congress who complained on Twitter that Doug Jones supporters are registered felons. But black women, that was a tangent, but it is a good one, Black women. But while you're in your feelings, Congress has voted to repeal Obamacare 60 plus times. Republicans trying to do magic tricks to undo this large piece of the last real president's legacy, even repealing a major part of it in the tax reform bill. While you're in your feelings, more mass shootings have occurred. While you're in your feelings, police violence, unequal pay, Trump attacking everybody from Kim Jong-un to Jemele Hill. While you're in your feelings, your president is showing you the bigot he is because he wants more people from Norway and the United States and less from El Salvador and Haiti. Oh, in Africa, somebody should tell him that it's not a country, it's a continent, and it's a rich one, the mother of civilization where all of us came from. So again, I say, to hell with your feelings. We have to start understanding the importance of the demands we seek. In activism circles, we say, what do we want? Ooh, there's no activists in here. I'm gonna tell y'all, what do we want?
That's good. I thought there was about 10 of y'all, maybe. When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
I think that's the wrong ask. I think that's the wrong ask. I don't think we want justice. Justice is the principle of dealing fairly, but I told you about power. Not even peace. I'm not trying to start war, but not peace yet. Power, the ability to achieve purpose. We want all of us to be able to live on purpose. If we lived on purpose, understanding that we're truly interdependent, we can move this nation and this world forward. Forward. But it's been the manipulation of power we're afraid of. Power has been used to oppress, and so we are afraid of seeking power. But power is our first ask. Of course, we want to be dealt with fairly. We also always ask for equality, but we're not starting from the same place. We need to be demanding equity. And I don't have time for that because I'm over time, because I got to catch this plane. But here's the thing that I want you all to know. We have to ensure our freedom. We have to fulfill Dr. King's legacy. He had some demands of us. We need to be okay with seeking power. We need to be okay with standing in unity, even if your struggle's not my struggle. I see you struggling. I can't let you do that. I'm sure we're all tired, but it's better for us to be all tired together and trying and striving. Intentions to impact. Can you imagine the impact we have if we stand together? If you want to honor Dr. King's legacy, don't just dream, work. If you want to honor Dr. King's legacy, don't just stay woke, work woke. If you want to honor Dr. King's legacy, don't just fight for equality, fight for equity. If you want to honor Dr. King's legacy, don't just pursue justice in love, pursue power in love. All power to the people.
Good evening. My name is Angie Patty, a Syracuse University senior, and one of this year's senior class marshals, alongside Gerald Brown. Joining me on stage is Brandon Munford, Alpha Phi Alpha president. Ms. Rye, on behalf of Syracuse University, I would like to thank you for being here to share in this celebration of Dr. King. You embody similar values as Dr. King, as your work has motivated young professionals to be active and aware about today's social issues. Syracuse University also thanks you for your incredibly inspirational and timely message for this community. As a token of our appreciation, we would like to present you a ceramic plate handcrafted by Professor Emeritus David McDonald. Thank you so much.
My name is Ashley Dixon, and I am joined by BCCE, and we're excited to perform a song I wrote called Honesty.
Sometimes you never know who you are until you learn who to be. But we've been moving mountains real far. You've got to just believe. And we could reach for the stars. Before it's our last breath. But what if I can't breathe? What if I can't breathe? With no room, no air. Where am I supposed to be?
Where am I supposed to be?
With no room, no air. Am I supposed to be with no room, no air? Am I supposed to be with no room, no air? Still believe in me. 'Cause I'm searching for honesty. If only freedom could love me. 'Cause I'm searching for honesty. If only freedom could love me. I wear the skin of my skin. I guess that means I'll never win. I wear the skin of my kin. Should that mean I'll never win?
I will win.
'Cause I'm searching for honesty. If only freedom could love me. If only freedom could love me. Am I trapped in my armor? My kin we will garner. Don't feel trapped by your armor. If you take my hand, we'll be stronger. I'm searching for honesty. If only freedom could love me. Oh, I'm searching for honesty. If only freedom could love me. I'm searching for honesty.
We are Raíces Dance Troupe, and we're excited to be performing tonight to Un Morenito Coqueta.
Y así debe ser. Ladies and gentlemen, performing now will be the Black Celestial Choral Ensemble and the 2018 MLK Community Choir singing Intentional, written by Travis Green.
Come on and praise the Lord, everybody. I'm sorry, I can only be me, so I'm gonna say it again. Praise the Lord, everybody. I don't know about y'all, but I'm so glad that God chose to come and die just for me. I don't know about y'all, but I came to lift up the name of the Most High God. Is that all right on tonight? Come on, we just want to sing this song real quick. Come on, everybody wave your hand like this, just up. Come on, I'll see your hands moving. Oh, 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 oh.
Every little thing
is working for me.
It's working for me.
It's working for me.
I don't have to worry. I don't have to worry.
I don't have to worry.
Cause
it's working for me.
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 Cause he's intentional.
My name is Sylvia Langford. Wow. The Unsung Hero Awards are presented annually to people who have moved beyond their comfort zones and made a difference in our community and in the lives of others, but who have not been widely recognized for their efforts. We seek to honor those who exemplify the spirit of Dr. King's life and work this evening. There will be short videos highlighting each award recipient. Allow me to please thank the Newhouse School of Public Communications, in particular Professors Bob Emerson and Bruce Strong, and Professor Strong's students for producing the videos. Thanks. Thanks also to Jackie Untano of the Carrier Dome for her technical support. It is my privilege to present these awards to people before you. Thanks to Chancellor Kent Siverud and the University Marshals, Joe Brown and Angie Patty, for their assistance. Okay. Chris Burns, would you please join me at the podium?
Coach Chris is a very unselfish person. He's dedicated to working with inner city kids. He is totally unselfish in his dedication to kids and the operation of this facility. This is not a job that gets a lot of attention. It's not a job that makes a lot of money, but it's a job that is self-fulfilling for those of us that have that type of a commitment to bettering the community. I think it's more than appropriate that he's finally getting some type of recognition because he's a very humble kid. He doesn't like, he's not egotistical in any way or such. He likes to just do his thing and he doesn't really like to be acknowledged. I don't think it's necessarily that they're deprived kids or poor kids, but he truly enjoys working with kids. We believe that boxing, as tough a sport as it is, teaches them punctuality, discipline, organization, commitment, goal setting, and cooperative skills, all of which can be transferred through life situations to be successful citizens. So that's really what me and Chris and Ray believe we're doing. He just is a indispensable part of this organization. It really is he that makes this whole thing function. Coach Chris, thanks for 10 good years, buddy. keep your hands up.
Keep working till the bell's done. Keep going, keep working, keep working. Bell ain't done. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Time.
Christopher Burns, we salute your service to others and your commitment to the principles embodied in Dr. King's life and work. We are honored to present you with the Martin Luther King Jr. Unsung Hero Award. They will continue. Ed Beauford and Arthur Bob Harrison, please join me at the podium.
The major reason we're here is to combat some of the violence in the community. Kids in our community are being killed at such rapid rates that we had to try to intervene ourselves to become part of the solution instead of the problem. We established this center to have a place for the youth in the community to have a place to go at and stay off in the street corners and stuff like that.
We try to, stop kids from fighting or killing one another, If you want to fight, come down here when we get in the ring and put the gloves on to fight. You ain't gotta worry about shooting one of those. If you shoot one of somebody, you going to jail.
Now get out, what are you going?
They've been best friends since they were maybe 8 or 9. Bob, when he was younger, he got into some criminal trouble, but he learned from that. Ed is the 1969 Golden Gloves, National Golden Gloves champion in the light welterweight division.
1, 2, 2, 3, 2. Yeah. 1, 2.
Bob and Ed are definitely more than coaches. They feed kids, they bring kids clothes, and just those few things right there is more than coaching.
They come out of their pocket with a lot of things. They continue to battle, and not only did they battle, but they succeeded. They're back and they're doing great things. Our kids need to see that. I feel like they should be honored. They should be recognized for what they do. And because they're very humble, they're not going to say, hey, look at me. They're going to say, this is just something that we do.
We salute your leadership and service to others and your commitment to the principles embodied in Dr. King's life and work. We are honored to present you with these Martin Luther King Jr. Unsung Hero Awards.
We thank you. We appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you. Dominique Donnay, would you please join me at the podium?
When I got the phone call, I went to my mom and I told her. And she was excited. She started to tear up a little bit. And I asked her why why did they pick me and not somebody else?
I saw the flyer for the award, and I felt like Dominique, it described him. He works very hard with the school district. He's very dedicated to helping make a positive change.
He's a very detail-oriented guy, and he's a visionary with leadership qualities that are beyond anything that you would typically see in a youth and in many adults.
Dom is a natural leader. He leads by the amount of community service he does, showing students that it is possible to give back to the community and have causes that you care about.
He's very dedicated to his schoolwork. He's dedicated to the community. He's dedicated to his family. He is a wonderful son. He is a great big brother, younger brother. He's an excellent role model.
Determined, stay dedicated, motivated, inspired, and do whatever you have to do in order to achieve a goal. For me to, you know, get out of bed and volunteer, it just comes natural to me.
He's my hero, so I just took a shot in the dark.
Dominique Donnay, we salute your advocacy and service to others and your commitment to the principles embodied in Dr. King's life and work. We are honored to present you with the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Unsung Hero Award. Keenan Lewis, would you please join me at the podium?
When I think the term unsung hero, I think of that person who's doing a work but not really looking for the accolades or the rewards to go along with it. He's doing it because it's in his heart. He's doing it because he cares about the community.
Keenan's very humble, so he probably wouldn't even call himself a leader. He would still probably just say, I'm just a helper. He has a radio and TV program called I Know I Can Radio and Television that inspires and empowers the community.
All right, all right, all right. It's another Thursday.
Yes, it is.
Welcome to I Know I Can Radio. I'm your host, Keenan. Big love out there. Big love out there for everybody who's joining.
People see my story. They see where I came from. They seen the life that I lived. They seen the changes that I made. So it's good to put my story out there because I'm okay with living it and being okay with helping others and not being seen. But sometimes it is good to be seen so people can relate.
I think it's good for the community to get more information out there to what's available and to show where you are is not the end of the road. Things can be better.
You think about Keenan and his willingness to volunteer, his willingness to work with his peers, other young men, his willingness to work with youth. These are all major components that are needed for healthy communities. So for him to be the kind of unsung hero that he is, makes all the difference in the world to seeing a better Syracuse, a better tomorrow.
Keenan Lewis, we salute you for your fortitude and service to others and your commitment to the principles embodied in Dr. King's life and work. We are honored to present you with this Martin Luther King Jr. Unsung Hero Award. Robert Bob Wilson. Please join me.
Through these doors come Syracuse University's best students. I'm a first-generation student. I come from a working family, and so there was an affinity between my own experience and some of the opportunities I was provided with some of the work that we do here in providing opportunity for students who might not otherwise get this opportunity.
Bob will make it his point to know who the students are, meet them, know their faces, know their history, understand their challenges.
So for me, I felt like his attitude was just something that always keeps me going, because he's always giving me like advice and like, it's all right, keep going.
More than anything else, I think, is a father. He wants for all of the students he works with the same thing he wants for his own children.
This is just so rewarding in terms of the successes that our students and alumni achieve.
Robert Wilson, we salute you for your advocacy and service to others, and your commitment to the principles embodied in Dr. King's life and work. We are honored to present you with the Dr. Martin Luther King Unsung Hero Award. Would all of the recipients please stand and come forward. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the 2018 Martin Luther King Unsung Heroes. Where did Steve go? Okay, we'll go. We can go. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening. We are Syracuse University's Black Legacy a cappella group, and we will be performing a medley of gratitude with songs written by Kirk Franklin and Richard Smallwood.
I give you the
good to me. I'm so grateful for my blessings, giving you all the praise. Lord, you've been so good. You've been so good to me. I'm grateful for all of my blessings, giving you all the praise.
My Lord loves me.
Oh, yes, he does.
My Lord loves me.
Oh, yes, he does.
My name is Bridget Ewell, the 2018 MLK Committee Chairperson. As we move towards the closing of tonight's program, let us once again congratulate all of the award recipients tonight. On behalf of the Martin Luther King Jr. Celebration Committee and the University, I would like to say thank you to all the performers, the Awards Committee, the MLK Celebration Committee, and all of you for attending this evening's event. Please clap for everybody. Let us close now by joining hands around your table, if you are able, and lift our voices for the choir as we end tonight's program with the celebratory song, Reach Out and Touch Somebody's Hand. Thank you. Good night.
Reach out and touch.
dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed.
Yeah.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that my four children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character.
Yeah.
I have a dream today, when we let freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state to every city, when we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men, white men, Jews, Gentiles, Protestants, and Catholics, we'll be able to join hands and sing the words of the old Negro spiritual. Free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty.
I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Because I have a dream. My four little children one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
The American people have spoken, and they have spoken clearly.
An African American has broken the barrier as old as the Republic. An astonishing candidate, an astonishing campaign. A seismic shift in American politics.
If there is anyone out there who still doubts that America is a place where all things are possible, who still wonders if the dream of our founders is alive in our time, tonight is your answer.
Let there be no reason now for any American to fail to cherish their citizenship in this, the greatest nation on earth.
God bless you, and may God bless the United States of America.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the inauguration of the 44th President of the United States of America. The world is watching today as our great democracy engages in this peaceful transition of power. Future generations will mark this morning that this was the moment when the dream that once echoed across history from the steps of the Lincoln Memorial finally reached the walls of the White House.
I, Barack Hussein Obama,
do solemnly swear
that I will execute the office of President to the United States faithfully.
That I will execute
faithfully the office of President of the United States faithfully. And will, to the best of my ability, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. So help you God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
My fellow citizens, I stand here today